Welcome everybody to today's live coaching session on mastering mobile menus and device management. As you can see on the screen, the little image there, you can create very attractive mobile menus. So you can have different forms, multiple forms, projects. You can even have functions built into your menus, and you can have bottom banners that can be launching websites and other forms. So today we're going to show you how to do something like this. And as we go through the webinar, we're going to be jumping back and forth between here and the web client. So for those of you that may not know, there is a DoForms web client. Anthony, you can click on that. And you'll see that you can use a web client. People that use this are people like that want a Windows capability on, let's say, a laptop or a Surface Pro. There's an actual web client that replicates the exact functionality of a mobile client. And just to get started, I am John D'Arienzo on the mic, and today Anthony Trani is on keyboards. So literally, we are going to show you how to make some beautiful DoForms menus. So in order to get started, when you're in the mobile builder, you go to Manage, and you'll see a mobile app section. So today we're going to start out in the Appearance section. We're going to actually go to all three of those today before we're done. So the way DoForms works is when you talk about being able to put in a logo, you have two options. One option is you could put your logo into the logo section, and that will make your menu appear with just your logo up in the upper left-hand corner. Or you can put a banner graphic like we showed you before on that image, which will fill up the top section of the screen. And you can have a wide one and a narrow one. So the reason you would have two is, let's say somebody had a tablet and they were switching from portrait to landscape, and your image looked funny when they went to landscape, it looked stretched out. You could put a wide banner graphic, and it will basically, anything over 5 inches, let's say whatever number you set, it will switch between the wide banner graphic and the narrow banner graphic. The next most important thing to know about DoForms is you have several options for DoForms functions. So DoForms gives you the ability to have a ribbon bar. Excuse me. And in that ribbon bar, you can have all the different various DoForms functions. Now, you can turn those on and off. You can change the labels. So if you wanted to put foreign language labels under them, you can do that. You could even change the icons for anything up there. The functions will always stay the same. In other words, if you change the word forms to anything else, it'll still be the forms function if they click on it. If you change the icon, it'll still be the forms function if they click on it. But you can create a completely custom ribbon bar. And you could have as many of the items as you want in there, as few as the items as you want in there. Now, some of the items in your ribbon bar will be smart items. So as you have number of forms or number of projects or number of jobs, it will actually count for you, tell you how many things that you have in review and waiting to be sent on your device. So they're smart. Now, with DoForms, we have three different options for these functions. One option is you can put them all on the menu bar function. So all you have to do is go over to menu bar functions and click on and off the ones that you want to have in your system. Now, the ribbon bar is one option. The next option is in the corner, the upper right-hand corner of your menu, and you'll see it even when you're in a form, there are basically a little hamburger-like icon. And if you click on that hamburger-like icon right there, it will drop down and give you those same functions. So if you don't want to have a ribbon bar, you can just as easily create the menu bar, or you can have both. There's no reason you can't have both. As long as those things are checked, you will get both a ribbon bar and a drop down menu from that little hamburger icon. The third option you have is you can actually place these functions as icons right into the icon field in your form. So if you see here, jobs and incomplete and completed and sent, those are your functions appearing as icons right in your form body, right where your form icons would also appear. And once again, you can decide to choose which ones you want to see and which ones you don't want to see. There's also a feature that says, hey, if you only have one form, there's no reason to even see a menu. You could auto start if you only have one form by just opening that form up immediately. So if you want no menu at all, just auto start your project up if you only have one form. So as we go through, you know, you'll see a bunch of colors all over the screen. As you go through the appearance, you can change things like the color of the wallpaper, what's behind those icons. You can change, you can actually put a wallpaper graphic. You can change the color of text. You can change divider colors, title colors. So, you know, you're going to have to play with this a little bit, but there's just a lot of different things that you can do as you're going through and, you know, messing around with this. Now, one of the things you can do, Anthony, go to, no, before you get that, go to the icon view, and change it to add frames around icons. So when Anthony does that and he goes back to, he's got to save that, and he goes back to the web client, you'll see right now you have no frames around the icons, but if he refreshes this, you'll see now your mobile appearance has changed again, and you now have frames around your icons. By the way, in a little while, we will show you how to put your own custom icons in. So it's very easy to do, and you could have your own custom menus with your own custom icons. So go back again, Anthony, and change it to list view now. So one of the options you have is icon view, but you can also change it to a list view. So Anthony's going to go in now, and he's going to just save it again, and we're going to go ahead and run it, and he's going to refresh that. And you'll see that it changes again, and it gives you, so he has frames around it. You may not want to have frames around it in the list view, but we don't, you know, we don't have to go back and change that. That's fine. So as we continue to go through this appearance section, you'll see the last thing in the appearance section is the banners. So you could put a bottom banner in and right there. And literally your actions are you could launch a URL or open a form. So you could have a bottom banner. And by the way, you could put this on and take it away. So let's say you wanted to have it's expense account day. You want everybody in the company to put their expense account in. You could put a bottom banner in there and then pick your expense account form. And your banner would say, today your expense accounts are due today. Click here to pick the expense account form. And it would automatically launch that form for you. So, you know, very, very powerful and very easy for you to send messages to your people and things of that nature. Now we're going to move on to some of the settings, some of the way you can control your device. So Anthony's going to leave here and he's going to go to manage mobile settings. There's a whole bunch of settings here. Like you can go in here and do portrait lock, and that will keep your device from rotating to the landscape. Some people find it very jarring when you do that. Now I want to make one thing clear. If you see up the top, it says prevent mobile users from changing. All of these settings can be managed centrally and or by the mobile user. If you click on prevent mobile user from changing, then they will not be allowed to change any of these settings. However, if it's a scenario where you don't care if the mobile user can manage their own settings, then you can effectively click on, you know, which items. And we broke it up so that, you know, you may not want them to mess around with the display settings, but you may want to let them manage the support settings. So as we kind of go through this thing, I'm not going to touch on every settings, but we'll try to touch on the important ones. You'll see a lot of things like allow remote support log access. So if you're having a problem with NuForms and our technicians are trying to help you, they may ask you to go in and check allow remote support log access so that we can remotely access your logs and find out what's going on. Or we may ask you send us your logs, where basically you could go in and your users can send us the logs directly. In addition to that, there's a number of things for housekeeping in NuForms. So you can say purge backed up forms on the device after so many days, don't back up at all, clear different things that are in there. You could show things that you want to have appear or not appear. And then there's all kinds of behavioral things that you know, skip auto updates on startup. I'm not going to go through all of them, but look at them. They're here. You know, your dispatch check interval, that tells it how often it should check the system to check to see if it has new jobs. Your tracking interval, in this particular case, Anthony could set that to 3 minutes. If he sets that to 3 minutes, your device will automatically start tracking. And the way this works is it uses 100 meters of accuracy. So if you start moving, it can automatically detect if you've stopped and automatically detect if you've started moving. And it uses that 100 meters to say, if I haven't gone more than 100 meters in, let's say, 3 minutes, then I've stopped. Or if I'm stopped and all of a sudden I'm 100 meters away, then I've started moving. It's very, very accurate. In addition to that, it will also give you speed, direction, miles traveled, a whole bunch of information. And you can see it all on a map right in NuForms. The other thing you could do is not everybody wants to have their people, you know, tracked 24 hours a day. People will complain that they're being tracked on weekends or weeknights. You could literally go in here and create a tracking schedule that will only track your people on weekdays, not weeknights, not weekends. The other thing you'll see in here is things like image scaling. So, you know, what we do there is just because, you know, your device has a 13 megapixel camera, it doesn't mean you could take 113 megapixel pictures. So if you start scaling your pictures down, you could actually take more pictures and be able to effectively fit them in a form and communicate them back effectively and email the PDF. Otherwise, you'll wind up creating a form that has so much data in it, it'll be ineffective for you. Very powerful feature to be able to actually control the size of the images being taken remotely. You know, things like check for updates after save and send. That's telling you how often you want your device to check to see if there's new data or new form changes for you. There's just different restrictions in here and different things that can be seen as you're going through. And the last thing I want to cover here on sort of what you can do on your device is security. So for every single device that you set up, every single user that you set up, you give them a PIN. It could be between 4 and 8 digits, that PIN. And effectively, you could set up PIN-based security, which means if you click on request PIN, then every time that person goes to log into DoForms, it's going to ask them to type in their PIN. And you could say block after 5 attempts, remove block after 5 minutes, and you can have an activity timeout. So you could say, hey, I don't want my device being left on a forklift somewhere and somebody could go over, pick it up, and start playing with DoForms. So if that person hasn't done anything in DoForms in a minute, we're going to time that out, and they come back, they're going to have to retype in their PIN to get back into that session. And there's a message that you could put and, you know, please enter your PIN. So once again, if you want to have security in DoForms, you could have full-blown security at the mobile level just by clicking on request PIN number. Now, the last thing that we're going to talk to you about today is a little bit of user variable management. And in user variables, we're going to basically explain what that means. What that means is that you may have certain devices. Let's say you give a device to a particular person and he drives a particular vehicle every day and they have an employee ID. Well, Anthony can go in here now and he could put questions that we're going to have ask the person the first time they download DoForms. So it's going to ask them for their employee ID. They're going to pick a type text, maybe put a vehicle number in Anthony and ask for a vehicle. And what Anthony's doing is he's setting up a list of questions that it's going, the app is going to ask the person using that particular thing to input that information. Now, when Anthony clicks on ask, that means it's going to ask that person. You could still create these user variables and fill them out yourself centrally. And you could allow the person to edit their own variables. And you could say, if the person changes a variable on their side, sync it so that I could see what that variable is that they changed back at the portal. So it's a very powerful feature that allows you to create user-specific variables. Now, what does that mean? If you build a form, and one of the things you want in your form is, what is the employee's ID? Well, that employee will never have to enter their employee ID or vehicle number again, because you could put a calculation field in a form, set it equal to vehicle number and employee ID, and then every time that form is opened, it will automatically set that to the employee ID and the vehicle number for that particular employee's device that they set up when they first got asked. So Anthony, go into the web client, and what you'll see here is if Anthony refreshes now, because that information is missing, it knows to ask for it. So now it's saying, give me your employee ID and give me your vehicle number. And now, if you build a form, it will ask for that information. Now, if Anthony goes into My Info, you'll see that that info is there. And if they change it because he clicked on Edit the Capability and he clicked on Sync, not only will that edit it there, but if we went back in and looked at the user in the User Management screen, so go to Manage Mobile Users. You will see that those two variables are there and that data has been synchronized across the air effectively to reflect that. So if Anthony changed it again and we went back in there, you don't have to do it. But yeah, if you change it again, that would be reflected because we had sync on. So this is a very, very powerful feature that basically allows you to, you know, eliminate a lot of error, because let's say you're dependent on that employee ID and vehicle number and they type it in wrong one day or something, you know, that could lead to error in your back end data. So,
yeah, just one thing to add, John. So if you do not have the ask setting on, that entire process that we just went through on the web client here, where it prompted me to enter those questions, that won't appear. It'll be expecting you to go into Manage Mobile Users and to fill out that information yourself. The same goes with the sync. If the sync is off and my user in the field makes a change to his variable, it's not going to sync back to the portal and I'm not going to know the updated value of that.
And what type of questions can they ask, Anthony? You said you hit on types before. You have text in there, but you can also
text, integers, dates, phone numbers, email address, and a text with a numeric lock. So that could be things where if you needed to put a dash, 123 dash.
Right.
124.
Right, the employee ID maybe has a dash in the middle.
Exactly, an email address will prompt the user to have a at symbol and a .com in it to verify that it's an actual email address. Phone number will do the parentheses around the first three digits and give you a little bit of a format, so on and so forth.
Go back to the web client, Anthony, because I just want to let everybody know. In order to use the web client, you basically type in myduforms.com/web client. It will ask you for your user ID and PIN, and it will load the web client up for you. But just be careful, because in DoForms, you're allowed one access point. So if you're using a mobile license and then you switch to this, it will actually, you know, say, hey, you're trying to use two licenses on the, you know, with this two different devices. So if you have people that want to use laptops, you have people that want to use Windows devices, Surface Pros, things of that nature, you could very easily go into the web client and start to give them still the same exact access that your mobile users would have on iOS and Android. So that ends today's live session on live webinar on mobile menus and device management. Feel free to give us a call, ask us any questions, go on chat, or go to the YouTube channel if you'd like to watch this webinar on demand. Thank you.